Now I want to talk a little bit about some different types of studies that we're going to be getting into a lot more as the semester goes on. So we're going to start out here with non-experimental types of studies, which most often look at behavior that occurs naturally. This can, well, it's most often done in the field. This can be done in public places. It can also be done in businesses, anywhere where people consent to be studied. One of the more interesting versions of this is looking at just individual cases. So sometimes, due to circumstance, disease, brain abnormalities, certain individuals can come along that are really interesting to investigate. One of the most famous ones, of course, is this guy. It's a little gross, but we all know the story of Phineas Gage. Poor guy got his head spiked through with a railroad a spike, and it took out a significant portion of his frontal lobes. What was so interesting about this is that at the time, in the I believe late 1800s, when we didn't know much about the frontal lobes, we had really no idea what they were used for, and it took an extreme case like this for us to figure out what exactly they do, that they're in charge of things like behavioral inhibition, personality, thinking and planning for the future, all that kind of stuff. And we really only figured that out at first by having a case like this come along and study how he changed before and after his accident. So lots of cases in the literature on interesting case studies. Later on we might talk about the case of Jeannie, which was a girl who was basically left to her own, socially isolated for the first 13 years of her life, which is, again, a lot of these are very unfortunate cases, but interesting cases psychologically. How does someone progress and learn and develop emotionally and socially with such high amounts of neglect or with such specific types of brain damage can make for some really interesting case studies. So that's one that it doesn't tend to come up a lot in modern research, but once in a while, an interesting case presents itself that is really illuminating research-wise. So much more common under this umbrella are naturalistic observation studies, and this is observing people in their natural habitat and natural settings. I tried to pick an interesting one here, and I think I did. Recently, and actually they do this every once in a few years, the American Society for Microbiology tests whether people actually wash their hands in the restroom. So they do this in a very covert way, because obviously if you just ask people whether they wash their hands, and in fact they did this, they find in surveys, vast majority of adults, no surprise, say they wash their hands every time they go to the bathroom. So this is one of those things where people will obviously lie because it's not seen as such a good thing to say that you don't wash your hands after going to the bathroom. In fact, I'm surprised that even 4% of people said, you know what, I don't care, I don't wash my hands, don't worry about it. So most people obey at least the social convention to say they wash their hands. But what they do is they have experimenters hide in stalls. They put in a little out of order sign in front of the stall. And then they listen, and they listen for bathroom activity, number of times people wash their hands, and they calculate at the end of the day how many people went to the bathroom, how many times the faucets were on and off, and how many people actually wash their hands or not. And now they can even do this electronically by electronically recording like when people are using the restroom and how often the hand washing machines are turned on. So in actuality, things aren't as bad as you might expect. Vast majority of women do in fact wash their hands when they covertly observe them. Only about 3% of women lied about it. But boy, the guys, not so good. Only about three quarters of the guys actually wash their hands in these nationally representative studies. So a lot more lying guys when it comes to women. Of course, this is in the US, and we're actually a lot better in the US than in most parts of the world. They did a similar study in London a year prior and found that only two-thirds of women and only about a third of men wash their hands in public restrooms in London. So if you're going overseas, just be aware of that. So that's an interesting type of experiment where you can really catch people in real behavior, which is, I think, fascinating for social scientists because we're often worried about people lying or misrepresenting themselves. And that's sort of the key point to this next part or this next type of experiment, the survey, because it is really prone to lying, not just misrepresentation, like a conscious misrepresentation, but even unconscious misrepresentation. People not really knowing how to answer questions or how to honestly answer questions. But it's still one of the easiest, cheapest, and sometimes best ways to get at information is just to ask people about it. So oftentimes it's the only way to get at things that are happening internally. So thoughts, feelings, past experiences that weren't directly recorded, that sort of thing. But we're going to get into sort of some of the problems with this here, with this example. So in the 1970s, one research, and this became a very famous study, found that there was a high correlation between self-esteem and grades in African-American children. So this was an interesting finding because he was trying to figure out why African-American children underperformed in schools. And he found that actually those who had high self-esteem, so sort of a good self-view, did really well in school. So this was an interesting finding. He sort of jumped the gun, and a lot of other researchers jumped the gun in trying to posit that this meant that if you increase kids' self-esteem, it increases their grades. But this is not necessarily the case, and this is what can often plague survey research, is this question of causality. So it could be that raising kids' self-esteem could cause them to have higher grades. It could also be that just having higher grades raises self-esteem, sort of a reverse causality. Could also be that there's lots of third factors, maybe having good parents, having affluent background, having, you know, types of friends who uplift you and who provide positive role models might provide both good self-esteem and good grades. So this is what we call the third variable problem. This is when any number of extraneous variables, remember we just talked about those variables that affect the DV that we might not even be aware of, are causing relationships that we see. So in this case, there are many third variable problems. So there could be basically good background, so good parenting, good schools, more affluence, more wealth. Also just higher confidence. Maybe there's something to do with actually working on your self-esteem, but more in a confidence sphere of self-efficacy beliefs, and having a better work ethic that causes both high self-evaluations and better work performance. It could even be something related with genes. Believe it or not, self-esteem is about 50% attributable to heritability, meaning that genes account for about 50% of variability in self-esteem. And we know that genes count for a lot more of that, a lot more variability when it comes to intelligence, more around 80 to 90%. So there could just be a genetic link there between high self-esteem and intelligence. So one of the problems with doing surveys, but also a lot of non-experimental work, is just if you can't isolate variables, if you can't control for them like you can in experiments, which we'll talk about here in a bit, it's really hard to rule out extraneous variables as the causes of relationships or group differences. And sometimes things can be causally related, but in a way that you didn't think. So this whole third variable problem, this is why we always say in psychology, do not confuse correlation with causation. Basically, what it's meaning is just because you found that two things were related to each other, that there's a correlation, doesn't necessarily mean that one is causing the other, or at least not in the way that you think they are. We often call this spurious relationships. This is when the relationship between two variables is actually caused by some unknown, unaccounted for third variable. And there's many, many examples of this. You can especially find it if you look for coverage of science in the news media, because often the news media it tends to be very bad about confusing correlation with causation. They'll have some tentative finding that two things are related, and the news media says, well, this must mean that A causes B, when that's often just not the case. In fact, this whole claim that high self-esteem causes academic success, we later found out in the 80s and 90s, is simply not true. If you increase people's self-esteem, they don't do any better in school or at work. In fact, they can sometimes get worse. They can become narcissistic and thus think they don't need to prepare as much for school because, hey, I'm so great, why do I need to study? And that can actually drive down performance. So sometimes they can turn out to be the exact opposite of what you initially think it is. But there were some interesting ones in the news media lately. One article that came out a year or two ago simply said that having more books in the home helps children go to school. So this, of course, came from a correlational study and actually a survey study to boot, that just showed that people who had more books in the home, their kids ended up being more likely to go to school. But obviously, there's many different reasons that could explain that finding. Probably the fact that there's more books in the home indicates that the parents are more educated, that they think reading is important, that they're probably more involved in their child's learning. And all these factors are much more likely to be related to a kid going to school than just merely having books in the home. You hear a lot of times about correlational studies about, you know, where you live affects you. So it's common to find articles about how living in New York or there's a few other states lumped in here, New Jersey, Connecticut, can raise your general anxiety level. This is simply comes from the fact that there's more cases of generalized anxiety diagnosed in New York than in other parts of the country. Well, that kind of makes sense when you consider the fact that there's more psychiatrists in New York than any other part of the country. So more opportunity for diagnosis. It could also be that people who are more anxious, more driven, because often anxiety is related with higher work productivity, end up in high bustling places like New York. One that I particularly like, well, I'll show both of these, is having to do with prevention of Alzheimer's. So you hear about this all the time. If you keep your brain active, it will lessen your chances of getting Alzheimer's. If you eat nothing but fish oil and kelp, you'll lessen your chances of Alzheimer's. And one that came along recently, which I really liked, if you use marijuana regularly, you're less likely to get Alzheimer's. Well, all of these studies come from mostly survey research, but all of them are correlational data. And in fact, in 2012, there was a big panel of Alzheimer's research authorities who looked at all of the research on Alzheimer's and Alzheimer's prevention, dementia prevention, and they concluded unequivocally that so far we know of nothing, no medication, no behavioral treatment, no intellectual therapy, nothing, no food, no diet, no exercise that actually prevents Alzheimer's. All of the research that you read about in the news that comes up almost every week, you hear about some new thing that's supposed to stave off Alzheimer's or dementia, because it is something that a lot of people are afraid of. All of that's based on correlational research, usually not very good research anyway, not big samples, not very representative samples. But so far, whenever they've done a controlled clinical trial of a substance like vitamin E and different medications and diets and exercises, even intellectual exercises, they've never been shown to have any effect on Alzheimer's whatsoever. So it's one of those things where you really got to figure out where information is coming from, even if it seems legit and it's frequently cited in newspapers. Sometimes that doesn't really mean anything more than something's correlated.